So good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to welcome to the last session of GrowthNet. I know many of you may have started very early in the morning and continuing now right through dinner. And so we do appreciate your interest in GrowthNet. And this evening we have with us Mr. Amitabh Kant. And Amitabh has, you know, had a wonderful career and is currently managing the NITI Aayog, which is the erstwhile planning commission. And it's really a policy sort of think tank that is comes up with wonderful ideas, but eventually everything has to get implemented somewhere else, right? And I think that, you know, we've over the last 2 days we've had such an in-depth discussion on different topics. The last topic we had was on urban development, civil aviation, and industry and commerce. Amitabh, you've done all these, and not only that, but you're an author. You've written the books and coined slogans. And so I think, you know, as we enter into this second phase of the government, I think we wanted to get a sense of what is going to be different. You know, is it going to be different? What's going to be different? Why is it going to be different? And maybe the government actually can take more risk now, because, you know, they've achieved something in the first term. They've come back with a renewed mandate, which is very strong. And I suppose they can afford to take a little bit more risk now. And but, you know, remember the last time we had met, it was all about mobility. And you were very much in the forefront of that. And how do we get India onto the path of mobility, electric vehicles, autonomous vehicles, taxis, et cetera, et cetera. And that was, again, a very, very successful project. And I think over the years, since you left DIPP and you've been in NITI Aayog, you know, you've been able to put all these ideas into place. And I think one of the points that came up, and Claude Smaja earlier was saying that, you know, one of the deficits in India is execution. And he was really asking, you know, how do we execute? And Hardeep Puri, who was here earlier, really talked about, you know, the very ambitious housing project for affordable housing and how fast it's moved ahead, actually. And so I think, yes, execution certainly is critical, but I think you need good ideas also to be able to do that. And of course, all the big you know, ideas of Make in India and Startup India and all that, I mean, you've been very much behind all these ideas and these positions. And of course, so, you know, what my question to you will be that how, I think we are in a situation today where growth has slowed down. I don't suppose it's entirely to do with availability of money or the cost of money. There are so many other factors also. So I think my first question to you would be, how do you see the economy, you know, currently, and what do you think really we should be doing to make a difference? Yeah, we know the budget's around the corner, etc. But I mean, is that the only thing that can make a difference? I'm sure there are other things also.
Jamshed, thanks for converting this from a monologue to a dialogue, and I really prefer this interactive session. So first and foremost, to my mind, the world of politics is over with the elections, and I think we should just forget politics. The challenge is the economy, and it's important that we take India to a high trajectory growth rate. We've been growing at about 7.5%. It's important that we raise the growth rate even higher because you are passing through a window of demographic transition, which rarely happens in history. And I think the mandate is for radical change. And you talked about implementation. One of the main reasons why this government has come back into power with such a resounding victory is because it implemented a vast range of programs, including electricity, housing, gas connection for all, and roads in rural areas in a very, very efficient manner, which the country had never seen before. So people in rural areas saw a lot of good implementation. Now, as far as the economy is concerned, my personal view is that a lot needs to be done. And first and foremost, there's a challenge of credit flow. One is that after the ILFS crisis, because banks in India had become risk averse, they were lending through NBFCs. Once the ILFS crisis happened, banks have slowed down their lending completely to NBFCs, and therefore there is a challenge of credit flow. My view is that it's not through the NBFC, but the banks must be capitalized fully and banks must lend. That's the way lending is done, and banks must lend. But to my mind, the real challenge is to quickly make the economy take off. Even if you were to attract investments from across the world, greenfield projects would take time, 3 years, 4 years, implementation would take time. And therefore, the fastest way is to push private sector investment, and that's the only way the economy must grow. Bring back the animal spirits, bring back private sector investment, and for private sector investments to happen quickly, the government must push a rapid process of asset monetization. That is, assets which are owned by government must be monetized quickly. And there's no reason why government must own stadiums. There's no reason why government must own pipelines. There's no reason why government must own a huge amount of spectrum. There's no reason why a company like BSNL should have 47 holiday homes. Why? There's no reason why the government should have Ashoka Hotel. All this should be privatized quickly. And secondly, there should be a major the NITI Aayog has recommended a vast range of public sector enterprises for privatization, and those should be put out very speedily for disinvestment. And that would bring, you know, it's far easier for brownfield projects which are de-risked completely, which are already operational, for private sector to come in. And therefore, my view is that there is a huge potential as far as disinvestment is concerned, and as far as asset monetization is concerned. If the government was to push it rapidly, you'll see a huge amount of private sector investment, and we've seen this just before the elections. We did disinvestment of 6 airports. And we had huge, it was one of the most transparent competitive bidding process. We saw huge interest from across the world into those airports, and we got very good bids. So I don't see why the Airport Authority of India should be running so many airports. We should put them out into private market. And that would really bring in productive efficiency into the economy. That will kickstart the economy. That will bring back credit flow. And that will ensure that the large groups get into investments in India. That's the way to go. Yeah. But there are large sectors of Indian economy which still remain unreformed. Look at coal. Why should there not be commercial mining, which the government has already approved? Huge reforms in the mines and mineral sector. You have huge resources there. Huge reforms required in oil and gas sector. Massive reforms required in energy sector. These are sectors which have bypassed reforms, and these need to be pushed very radically with great vigor, with great energy.
You know, one of the impediments which we seem to have failed in, or it's more like a self-goal for us, is that we always say, yes, we want something like privatization, we want reforms, but then we pull back on something or the other. And do you think that the atmosphere today is such that we can go all out in this way? Because, you know, if you do go all out, then there's also the question of where the resources are in the private sector, etc., which means that you must be open to global investment. So I think, you know, these things get connected at some stage here.
So 3 things. One is that, you know, in 1991, India pushed major radical reforms. There was no pushing back from that point of time. This government itself has brought in very radical structural reforms. It's brought in goods and services tax, which has replaced 17 different taxes. It's the same government has brought in insolvency and bankruptcy code, which has ended crony capitalism in India. It's brought in the Real Estate Reforms Act, which is massive. And lastly, it has brought in the direct benefit transfer, where, you know, we use all money gets into the bank account and people withdraw based using their biometrics. So radical reforms have been brought in by this government. It's shown the political and the administrative will to push reforms. There's no reason with such a large mandate why it will not push for reforms. I mean, all indications are that it will push for very major radical reforms in the days to come. And as I said, politics is all over. It's just the economy, and therefore economic growth is the key. Without growth, you can't create jobs, and growth with jobs is really the challenge before this government.
Yeah. So I think we are also facing at the same time, you know, whilst there's a challenge of jobs, we're also facing revolutions like the Industry 4.0 revolution, etc., which is really about modernization. You know, it's not just about artificial intelligence or big data. It's really a sort of a theme for modernization of industry, become more competitive. You worked a lot on the ease of doing business, which is another, you know, crucial aspect of being able to attract investment also. My question really is that, do you think we can sort of assimilate all of this in a short time, say in a year's time?
Jamshed, what's happened in India is quite unparalleled. Actually, we are the only country in the world which has 1 billion biometrics. We're the only country in the world with 1 billion mobile. We're the only country in the world with 1 billion bank account. And look at our data consumption. Mobile data consumption in India today is more than the mobile data consumption of China and USA put together. And that's simply because there's been a very sharp fall in data prices in India. So what we are really doing is throwing up a lot of data, and the digitization process has been so enormous. 99.6% of Indians pay direct tax online. It's all digital. Look at the GST. It's all cashless, paperless. Look at the new Ayushman Bharat scheme. 500 million Indians getting insured, health insurance. That's more than the population of USA, China, USA, Europe, Mexico put together. It's all cashless, paperless. It's all portable. And the own government PFMS system is all digital. You can track payment to the last point in government, all digital. So what the government is really doing is throwing up a huge amount of data. And one of the main reasons why India jumped up 65 position in the ease of doing business was the process of digitization, that people didn't have to interact with the government. You can now talk digitally to different departments, and different departments speak digitally. So what the government is really throwing up is, unlike China, where data is owned by Tencent, Baidu, and Alibaba, and unlike America, where data is owned by Google and Facebook, in India, we've created public highways where you have a huge amount of data on the back of which private sector is innovating. So you have Google Pay, you have Beam, you have Phone Pay, you have Bank Pay, you have Paytm. I mean, look at the phenomenal change. State Bank of India took 110 years to acquire 350 million consumers. Paytm has done that in 2.5 years, 350 million consumers. So look at the speed of change because of this process. And I'm sure that this is exactly what is going to happen in electric mobility, where India has just 22 cars per 1,000 people. America has 980 cars per 1,000 people. Europe has 880 cars per 1,000 people. So the level of their transition will be very difficult in advanced countries, because the level of destruction of moving from combustion to electric will be very high. Whereas in India, from 22 cars, you'll be able to move very smoothly into electric mobility. And that's why we are saying that by 2023, all three-wheelers will be electric. By 2025, all two-wheelers will be electric, simply because in India, you have 70% of the vehicles are two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And to my mind, one of the biggest advantage, as the manufacturing process gets increasingly digitized, and manufacturing process is totally digitized now, one of the biggest advantages for India will be the fact that it's thrown up such a vast number of scientifically trained people through the huge investment it has made in its IITs and IIMs. And therefore, the manufacturing process is for the private sector really to advance very rapidly using robots, 3D printers. And one of the things we are doing in NITI Aayog is that we are disrupting the process of education in India. We are providing tinkering labs. We've created about 3,500 tinkering labs in schools, where from class 6 onwards, students get used to robots, 3D printers, Internet of Things, and we are finding these schools extremely innovative, and in the next 2 years, we'll be creating 10,000 tinkering labs. And same thing is happening with the startup world in India. It's such an innovative, unique startup world across agriculture, across education, across health. So India is truly disrupting the world in many, many ways.
Well, as you rightly said, you know, the challenges that we have because of our large population is enormous. Yeah. I mean, you know, this argument and debate about demographic dividend versus something other than demographic dividend being an advantage has always come up. But I suppose we have to assume that we have to take everyone with us.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think the biggest challenge is going to be for the bottom, you know, 30-40% of our population who, you know, both on incomes, jobs, you know, living conditions, their social status. I mean, that is going to be very crucial to get India, you know, really come up significantly. And all these schemes I know are partly aimed at that also. But no, you know, we have to be maybe more targeted.
So, Jamshed, you made a very important point because, you know, if you look at the map of India, the southern part of India does well, the western part of India does well, the northern part of India does reasonably well. But if you look at the map of India, there are 115 districts of India which keep India backwards. And most of them are in the eastern part of India. We don't call them the backward districts. The Prime Minister calls them the aspirational district of India. So we have a program called the Aspirational District Program, and we've identified 49 indicators across education, health, nutrition, skills, where we are tracking them on a real-time basis, real-time, minute-to-minute. And there's a huge competition amongst these 115 districts. And our challenge is that in 3 years' time, they must compete and become on par with the best district in the states on these 49 indicators, and 5 years' time, they must become the best amongst India. And we've involved a lot of NGOs in this process, Piramal Foundation, Tata Trust, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, all of them. And let me tell you, it's not an issue of resources, it's an issue of, you know, sheer willpower, lack of good governance. There's a huge absence here of teachers, there's lack of doctors, and what this has done is spurred competition. And this is real-time competition, putting out ranking in public domain, naming and shaming, and making good governance as good politics has really worked in the case of aspirational district program. So we expect that there'll be a huge transformation in education, health and nutrition on account of this.
Within 3 to 5 years?
I expect it in the next 5 years, India will be a radically transformed place as far as the Human Development Index is concerned, because these are slow-moving indicators. And these learning outcomes, for instance, you'll see a sharp jump up. You'll see a sharp jump up in health outcomes. And I hopefully, with this Poshan Abhiyan, you'll see a massive, massive jump in nutritional standards. Yeah.
So I think you've really been putting your finger on these key things. One more is to do with gender. You know, I think one of our strengths, of course, as a country is multiculturalism, etc. But sometimes, you know, this also comes in the way. And I think that, you know, it's been, you know, we've talked about it many times, that women's status in India, their education levels, their health levels, the fact that many of them get married young, and then, you know, don't have an opportunity to either have a career or... So how do you... I mean, this is a really deep sort of... not just demographic, but it's a deep social sort of system. And at some stage, we will also have to be able to address that, because without that, I think we will find it difficult to do all the other things that we want to do.
So, Jamshed, the challenge is that in India, only 28% of the women work. And the worldwide average is 48%. It's impossible for India to grow at high rates of 9 to 10%. till we don't bring in gender parity and make 48 to 50% of the women, you know, your working population, 48% has to comprise of women. Without that, it's not possible to grow at 9 to 10%. And if you were to make it, bring it on par with the world average of 48%, you'll be adding close to about $700 billion to India's GDP, and that's important. But the important point is that wherever we have given opportunity to women, they've outperformed men in every single walk of life. Every single competitive examining in India, women are doing much better than boys. You know, just to give you the example of my own college, St. Stephen's College, where I studied, it was an all-male bastion when I joined St. Stephen's College. When my daughter went there, by that time, almost 75% of the students on sheer merit were girls. Sheer merit. And the principal said that to ensure that St. Stephen's remains a co-ed college, you should give 10% extra marks to boys. You know, because the girls are doing better everywhere. Every single competitive examination, they are doing better. So one of the big programs of this government has been the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. That is the Save the Girl Child and Educate the Girl Child, which is having a huge impact. But I think the state governments on their own have done a lot. You know, for instance, girls used to get left out because the schools used to be far away. So they provided cycles to them. Many huge programs on nutrition have been carried out. There's a huge focus on learning outcomes for girls. And therefore, I envisage that states which have got left behind in some of these areas will catch up. Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Bihar, there's a huge focus on gender parity. There's a huge focus on girls' education. And the key really is about health and education outcomes. And if we are able to improve them, then really the quality of life improves, the human development index of India improves. But that's a very critical point. It's impossible for India to grow at 9 to 10% without gender parity. But men have a very critical role to play in this. You know, decision making is largely governed by men in India. And unless they give a huge role to women and put women in positions of power and positions of eminence, that would be the real big change agent. So everywhere, I think we need to consciously push for women into positions of power.
Yeah. So let me come to one of my favorite topics, which is the problem of air pollution in our cities. I think Delhi had this problem. I think even Bombay now has the problem. There are lots of other cities also. I'm just concerned that we are not able to actually do the right things in such a way that our cities, as they grow, also grow in a sustainable way with less pollution. I think it's not just air, it's water, it's sanitation, it's all those things. And we talk about it in urban areas, but I'm sure it's much worse even in rural areas. And so how do we move in this area a little more rapidly? Ideas that you've talked about, like mobility and these sort of things, certainly will make a difference. But we need much more radical action.
So Jamshed, the process of urbanization in India has just begun. It's ended in America, it's ended in Europe, it's nearing its completion in China. In India, it's just begun. And India is going to see about 500 million people getting into the process of urbanization in the next 5 decades. And every minute as we speak here today, there are 30 Indians who are moving from rural areas to urban areas. Now the challenge is that we must do innovative and sustainable urbanization. We can't repeat the mistakes which the West has made of sprawling cities where cities were made for cars and not for people. A lot of lessons come from the eastern part of Asia. How to recycle water comes from Singapore. Japan is a great example. Yokohama was able to reduce its waste by 38% because of a lady, very dynamic lady mayor. Or look at Kitakyushu, where the women of Kitakyushu rose in revolt against the government of Japan, because Kitakyushu became the most advanced city in industrialization. But the Dokai Bay on which it was based became completely yellow from blue. It was yellow, and the women of Kitakyushu said they rose in revolt. And Ministry of Trade and Industry, METI, which is a very powerful ministry in Japan, then decided to work in partnership with the women of Kitakyushu. And today, if you go to Kitakyushu, everything is recycled. Everything is recycled. It's one of the smartest cities. And therefore, my belief is that you can't have a smart city without smart people. I mean, the people of India should not let India down. And if you talk about air pollution, it's because people are not doing segregation at household level. And people must take the responsibility. Everything should not be left to the government. If you expect government to solve all your problems, that's not the way. It will never happen. And therefore, a lot of ownership, and especially the rich and the elite class of Delhi, are the worst polluters. They never segregate their waste at household level. And unless you don't do this, it will be very difficult to clean up. And therefore, it's important that we make responsible citizens out of Indians. And once you start doing that, cities will get cleaned up. And a great example of this is Indore and Bhopal. My dad visited Indore 5 years back. It was one of the filthiest cities of India. You go to Indore now, it's the cleanest city in India consecutively for 3 years running. I mean, the people of Indore have done it. But you people in Bombay don't do this.
Who led them?
The mayor of the commissioner of Indore. But the people joined hands. People collaborated in that effort. And therefore, there has to be a huge movement by the people of Mumbai and the people of Delhi. And to keep blaming government for all this is to my mind, government must lead, but the people must collaborate.
Yes.
And this must happen in every single city of India.
Correct. But you know, one of the structural problems on cities is that we don't have executive mayors the way that many Western towns do. And it's almost boils down to nobody's in charge. Hmm. And so it's a governance issue also.
Yeah, I agree. I agree that you need elected governance. You need it for 5 years. You need a mayor for 5 years. There are a number of challenges. But I think a lot of them...
grassroots action...
But the good thing that has started happening is now that the PM has personally has put all his political capital in cleaning up India through the Swachh Bharat campaign. So you'll see a huge movement. A lot of work has been done around ranking cities on dirt and filth and putting it in public domain, shaming them. So I think I expect that in the next 3 to 4 years, you'll see a huge improvement. In fact, we should do a ranking worldwide of every single city.
No, this is, I mean, air pollution and water pollution and management of these is critical. I mean, coming to water, again, we've been very shy of pricing water. I mean, we price electricity more or less, I would say, correctly. But we don't price water. And except for maybe a few places in India where they have made the effort to price water. How do we go about making people understand that water is a finite resource and it has to be either it has to be priced, it has to be recycled, reused, all of that?
So actually we export a lot of basmati rice, but actually we are not exporting rice, we are exporting water. Large quantities of water. And actually if you look back in history, Punjab was not a rice producing nation. It just pumps in water from the ground level. We are extracting water to a level where we now started extracting poison from ground level. You know, we've dried up our ground to that extent. And this is simply happening because we are not pricing water. And now that we've got biometric, we've got Aadhaar, we do direct benefit transfer, every single commodity, whether it is electricity, whether it is water, whether every single commodity, you want to assist people below poverty line, assist them, but do a direct benefit transfer. Price the commodity right. It must be market-oriented pricing. But you want to assist somebody below the poverty line, please go ahead and do it, but put it into his bank account and he's able to withdraw it using biometric. Why should you and I be subsidized on water? Why should you and I be subsidized on railway tickets? But that's what's happening. So I think the world of subsidies must end. And the minute you start pricing water, you'll get the right, you'll bring sanity in the management of water.
But do you have some thoughts on, you know, how should we go about it in the right way? I mean, obviously you have to talk about it, educate people, but I think there is this feeling that, you know...
I think you have to first create a huge fear element that India, you know, India is going to run out of water, totally. And this is right on our head. Exactly like Singapore did, that they were ending their treaty with Malaysia by 2011. And there were no option, there was no water. So you had to recycle water, you had to convert wastewater into water for human consumption. And everybody started drinking that water for human consumption. And you had to create dual pipe system, you had to do desalination, many things you had to do. You brought in discipline by that mere fact that there is India will, and I'm telling you, India is going to run out of water. So there is a huge amount of water. It's the challenge is not about water. The challenge is about the management of water. How do you recycle wastewater? How do you recycle every drop of water? How do you recycle? How do you use every drop of rainwater for human consumption? That is really the challenge.
You know what, in Bangalore, as you know, Bangalore is at a height. It gets all its water from the Cauvery down below. I don't know how many feet down below, a few thousand feet. And all the water gets pumped up into Bangalore. Okay, and then because it's not recycled and reused there, it all goes back down the drain again to, you know, flows down and then gets pumped up.
Yeah, but
so it's water and electricity.
Yeah, both.
Both, because for pumping water you need it, you know. And the correlate here again is with agriculture, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, our agricultural practices have been there for a very long time. I think that also will have to change. So which crops? You mentioned, you know, the Punjab should be actually growing rice and wheat, whereas there are other places which could be rain-fed, which might be better. So I think this agricultural practices, something that we have not really talked about adequately and addressed, and we will have to do that.
Yeah, but you know, last few years, last 4 to 5 years, if you look at it, all states have focused on the management of water, particularly Maharashtra, huge amount of work around water. Look at Rajasthan, huge amount of work around water. Telangana, Andhra, whole focus of the political system has been on water. The challenge has been to be able to provide water to the rural communities in every single village. And the answer to this doesn't lie in large irrigation projects. It lies in community management of water. I think that is the whole thrust of the Prime Minister, putting the element of all elements of water under one ministry, which is the Jal Shakti Ministry. Mm. And the other is that states taking political ownership of water now in a very big way. And I think also that we are seeing some good examples of management of water, particularly in Nagpur city. I went to one of the slum areas, and the good thing was that there's a private sector player who manages water and supplies water to the slum area on a 24/7 basis. And the women there said that we are willing to pay any price for water because constant and regular flow of water 24/7 really removes all the diseases, brings in hygiene, brings better quality of life. And therefore, they said we are willing to pay any price. Yeah. So this this bit about not pricing water, people want water, people want to pay for water as long as they get water.
Yeah, correct. In fact, during the elections, one of the stories that was going around was about this lady who said that I will give my vote to whoever promises me 24/7 water.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think these are the type of themes that are going to actually make a difference. But somehow there is this reluctance in the political class to
not price only political water. Class, some of the economists also, as if water is a free commodity. So you have to change the mindset of Indians, and particularly of these economists who are talking about giving free water.
What's their argument for free water?
They think that there's an element of state giving free doles. To my mind, you want to give free dole, price it correctly,
correct.
But give it to people below poverty line.
Provide them the money to do it. Yeah. So I think, you know, we've covered a lot of ground. Yeah. I don't know whether you want to cover anything else before we go and take a few questions.
No, you've grilled me enough. It's time you allowed me to eat some dinner.
As they say, there's no free lunch or dinner. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think we've had a wonderful conversation here. And Amitabh has demonstrated to you his knowledge of all these issues. And, we obviously haven't covered everything. There's still trade. There's so much to be discussed. But we'll be happy to take a few questions and please try and limit your questions and comments and just mention who you are. Please.
Thank you, Chair. I'm A.K. Jain. I'm from the urban
can't
sector.
Hear you.
A.K. Jain, I am from the urban sector, and I had the opportunity to work with Amitabh for engage with the DMIC project, of which he was the chairperson. You have been a delight to, it has been a delight to listen to you. The only thing I am wondering, you never mentioned about the jobs. This is a very critical issue, how we are creating jobs. And the problem is that jobs have to be linked with the space, because what happens in Shanghai or Singapore or New York or all these places, even Beijing, the commercial space in last 30 years have increased by 10 times. But in Delhi, Tejinder Khanna committee report said that it is only 15% achieved what was planned. So unless we have this, the space which is affordable, which can also serve to the informal sector, vegetable sellers, everyone, we are not going to solve this problem of jobs. So this is one issue on which I want your views. Thank you.
No, I think it's a very important question. You can't have growth without jobs. You need to create jobs. The jobs, one of the sectors you mentioned about is, construction and real estate. And I think part of the problem is that in the planning exercise that we do in India, we've copied the American model of sprawling cities. You can create a lot of commercial space if you were to do compact, dense, vertical development on the back of good public transportation. And actually, our usage of land in India is extremely poor because of that. There's land, but we don't utilize it effectively. And therefore, my view is that our urban planners must learn the art of very good compact, dense planning, as some of the East Asian countries, particularly Singapore, has done. That has demonstrated that compactness, denseness actually brings better livability. And commercial space mixed with housing gives you better livability. I mean, we had this crazy situation in Delhi where the Supreme Court issued orders to demolish all commercial spaces because some of them were in housing areas. It's totally wrong philosophy. I mean, for people to stay, commercial places must be close to their housing, so that they don't have to go to long distances.
Yeah. Walk to work.
So the American concept of urban planning is dead, and we should never be replicated in newly developing countries.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, please.
Amitji, I have met you in various conferences in the last 5 years.
Can you give your name?
Anil Verma, Chairman Anand Group of Enterprises. I have met you in various conferences in the last 5 years. This time I find you to be fully recharged. I hope you will do something different than the last 5 years. What are you going to do for the village people, rural rights, for whom there is much to be done? What do you propose to do for them?
Yeah, actually, one of the major programs I work on the aspirational district program, which covers about 23% of India's population, which is the aspirational district program. And it's all about education, nutrition, health, skills, agriculture in the rural areas, in the villages of India. And it's demonstrated in the last 1 year that radical changes have been brought in through the aspirational district program. We do a very, very, very focused program around these 49 indicators that we do.
So needs to be done there.
No. I work with the states and the district collectors on this. So I don't think that we need to carry the same good programs with greater vigor and greater energy to transform India.
Yes. Please introduce yourself.
Last question.
Sir, my name is Naresh Kumar Malik, and I am a member of Chamber of Industries, Gurgaon. My question is relating to bouncing of the checks. You see, you had introduced Section 138, but it is not that strong or that harsh. Cases are still pending in the courts. You see, I am also suffering. I mean, the rules should be very strict, and the penalty should be much more than what it is now. So, and the second is regarding the Rent Control Act, which was introduced somewhere in 1950s. This is the only act, you see, in India, Nowhere in the world you will find any rent control act. You have made so many changes, please change these also. Abolish this act for all. Because you see, the tenants are blackmailing the owners to a great extent.
Thanks for your inputs. I don't have solution to all of India's problems.
I know, but you see, one thing was done.
I've taken your suggestion on board and I'll put them to the right authorities.
Thank you.
But by the way, rent control exists in New York and London and lots of other cities. So we are not the only one. Yes, sir. Will you have a mic?
So let this be the last question.
Sorry?
You talked about pollution and you gave the example of Delhi and Bombay also. My question is related to the pollution. See, according to UN survey, 1.3 kg of solid waste is generated per capita in our country. And there are more than 4,500 cities and hardly two or three cities in the country are having technology and changing the solid waste to wealth in two, three countries. And that waste, solid waste, whether it's a bio-waste, whether it's electrical, electronic equipment waste, or whether it's a waste generated from the kitchen. No, and it is a proper, it's a good business plan. NGOs are earning out of this waste by converting into energy. So my question to you is, when there is a business opportunity, when technologies are available indigenously and from the abroad, what is the problem that why our waste should not be converted into wealth in the entire country? Why only one or two cities like Bhopal or Indore should?
Thank you.
This is my question.
Thank you.
And it will give job opportunities also. It will create many jobs and it will have a circular economy just like in Japan. There is a zero waste in that country.
Yep. No, I think it's a very important point you're making. It's a very critical point. And one of the major problems in India is this, that since we do not do segregation at household levels, all the waste gets mixed up. And the key is really about good segregation at household level. So Indore did this very effectively, segregation. It converted a lot of waste into manure. It's using a lot of waste into biofuels, is converting a lot of waste into electricity. It's fining its citizens very heavily, those who do not follow the rules. But huge movement, there's a sense of pride amongst the people. And that is what needs to be done here.
Yeah, correct. So, the Growth Net is actually a collaboration of three organizations. We have Ananta Center, CII, and Smaja and Smaja. And Mr. Smaja is here. And he was mentioning earlier that he, for the last 40 years, he was very sort of pessimistic about India, but now he's become very optimistic. So, do you want to ask him a question as to how he's changed his mind?
No, he's absolutely on the right track. I'm a great believer in India. I'm myself a great optimist in India, and I can assure you the best of India is to come, and we'll have very consistent and predictable growth in the years to come. We'll create a lot of growth with jobs, and there's a huge amount of political and administrative will to drive radical structural reforms in India right now. And so I'm really grateful, and I really appreciate his foresight, his vision, his clear perspective about India of the future.
Do you want to make a comment, Lord? No, okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think we've had such a wonderful evening listening to Amitabh, and I love the energy and the vigor that you bring to everything that you do. So, not only all the best, but thank you very much for being with us, and we will appreciate that.
So Kiran has reminded me that I have a formal duty to thank all of you being with us these last 2 days, and want to thank our partners in this endeavor, Ananta Center, CII, and Smaja and Smaja. We want to thank all of you for being here for the 2 days, and not only participating but offering your views at every stage. And this is, I think, I see GrowthNet has become, you know, one of our really big and key programs for development. And so this is another reason for us to be so happy about it. So thank you very much, and enjoy the dinner, and we'll see you next year at GrowthNet.